look at this fish. So I'm gonna get this guy right back in the water.
About 6 months after my first saltwater fishing trip of the year, I'll close out the saltwater season in pretty much the same way I began it, with a bucket full of green crabs and the hope of catching a keeper blackfish from my kayak. A kayak is a great platform for tog fishing. The small size allows you to hit smaller structure that's overlooked by larger vessels, and therefore less likely to be picked over. The challenge is anchoring precisely, an art I've yet to fully master. So I was excited when Kevin Blinkoff invited me to target tog in the new Old Town Sportsman Autopilot, a motorized kayak equipped with Minn Kota spot lock technology, which would ensure I'd sit directly over the structure without the need for an anchor. On a perfect late October afternoon, I meet Kevin on a Buzzards Bay beach to get the rundown on the new kayak and to look for a limit of blackfish.
Plugs in right here to your power source, easy enough. So here's your trolling motor battery. Comes in this case, battery drops right in, that gets strapped down, and then your battery connects here. There you go. And so you can plug the battery in there, plug the trolling motor in there, and then it's all pre-wired underneath, power directly to it. You got a kill switch, which connects right here. Once that's clicked in, completes the circuit, and so that means the engine, the Minn Kota trolling motor will run, clip this to yourself for safety, and if you fall off for any reason, pulls right out, motor stops running, and the kayak's not gonna run away from you. So this actually controls the iPilot trolling motor here. So the propeller button here, this is your on and off for the motor. Plus and minus adjusts the speed. This adjusts the steering, the arrows in each direction. And that's your spot lock button right there, that's the anchor. The motor itself is GPS enabled. You don't need to have a fish finder. It knows where it is on its own, and so when you hit that anchor button, it spot locks in place. It will adjust speed and direction to keep your kayak over structure. And that's gonna be key for us out there today, fishing for tautog. We're gonna wanna use that spot lock and anchor right up on structure so you can drop down, fish these rocks, fish these boulders. That's where the tautog live. You can steer with this, or you can keep it going. If your covering doesn't, keep it just pointed straight ahead at high speed and use the foot pedals to steer.
Sounds good. All right. I think I'm ready to go.
You're ready? We'll give this to you. We'll get you out in the water here and sit you down and launch you out.
Thank you.
Go.
Nope, no, I have to.
There you go. Now you hear it beep. That means it's getting power.
Okay.
All right. And now pull the rudder. There you go. Now you'll use the foot pedals for the rudder and go ahead and pull out your remote.
Got it. Okay. So I press this to get it going.
Turn the propeller on to start it, and then you do the speed with the plus and the minus.
Here we go.
There you go. All right, I'll be right out there. So I've got this set up. I've got a Humminbird Helix fish finder, transducers mounted right under the bow. And what's great is I just keep an eye and I got this split. I've got some spots on the GPS that I know I want to check out where I can see it looks like there's some rocks. But I'm watching the fish finder and I've got about 20 feet here, 18 feet. And now I see right now it just spiked up a little bit. So I got a boulder right here. So I turn this off. I hit this anchor button right here. Now it's spot lock. And so now I am locked on this boulder that I just saw. You can see it reverse me to put me back to right where I hit it. And now I just saw it come back up on the fish finder. So now I know that straight down here is that big boulder that's probably gonna hold some tautog. Drop a jig down, drop the crab down. If we get something right away, I think we stick here with it. If not, it's so easy to just take it off spot lock and move on to the next spot.
There we go.
Whoa, didn't take long.
Oh yeah. Oh, he's digging. It's so fun on this light gear. Oh, that's a nice top. Look at him go.
Oh.
Oh. That's a nice tog. All right. Got him. Beautiful. He looks like he's couple inches over keeper size. Nice healthy fish there. You can see the white chin starting to come out. That's a beautiful fish. We're gonna
keep this guy and hopefully get some more, maybe some bigger ones, maybe some throwbacks.
Let me get a hook out of him. There we go. Nice kayak tog.
Oh, there's a bite already.
Yeah, there you go. It's tough to know when to set the hook, right?
It takes a lot of swings and misses. I think he's got it. Yeah.
There you go. Nicely done, Jimmy.
This one's gonna probably be an inch or two short. Whoop. He was just a little bit short anyhow.
Good looking fish though. Had that orangey collar on him.
Yeah, oh, those males seem to get it. Oh, you're getting knocked too.
Ah, swing and a miss. That's gonna happen a lot today. Got about 17, 18 feet of water. I'm gonna drop down to the bottom. But you don't wanna jig it. You wanna just kind of find a place on the hard bottom and just hold there. And when the tog come biting, it's kind of a scratch, scratch, scratch. And then when you feel it, they really got it in their mouth, that's when you set the hook. It's not always the easiest thing. And I missed it. There he is. Oh, that's so fun. This guy's pulling a bit. This one's a little bigger. What a fun fight on spinning gear. You know, we're only in 17 feet of water, fishing these boulders. Pretty much anywhere around here, we're in Buzzards Bay, anywhere you find a good boulder could hold tog right now. And there's these fish, you can find them pretty much from Cape Cod right now all the way south into New Jersey. There he is. He's just short of keeper size, but a good sized fish.
There we go. Oh, whoa. Oh, oh boy.
Whoa, what do you got there? Jimmy, that looks like a big one.
Feels like a good one. Oh, it's a good fish.
Oh, nice, look at him. Nice tog, Jimmy. That's chowder right there, don't lose that guy. That'll get you through the winter.
So even though these are lighter rods, and they've got tons of backbone throughout them, even though that's bending almost to the grip, you can see that got him out of the structure just fine. That's easily a keeper tog. And like Kevin said, that is destined for the chowder pot.
How fun is that fight? They're bulldogs. They just dive straight for the bottom. They don't want to come up. They fight it every step of the way.
They are a very fun fish, and they've gotten a lot more popular over the past few years. So another thing about the tog is it has a very firm white meat to it. It holds up well in a chowder. So especially this time of year, you know, today's a beautiful day, but we've got some cold weather ahead, definitely soup and chowder season. I'm gonna bring this one back to Andy Nabreski. He makes a mean tog chowder, and he's gonna show us how to do it. But first, we've got a few more spots in our limits to fill.
Yeah, let's add a few more fillets to the chowder pot. All right, so I drop right down to the bottom, touch bottom, just barely lift it off, and just kind of hold it there. There's a scratch right there. There he is. Oh, nice. They are on it so fast. And these smaller ones, it's not a keeper, but they give a nice fight. It almost looks like a smallie when it's coming up. They have that real bronze color on them. Got kind of a rusty orange on it there. Just such a cool fish.
Yeah, so we've got, looks like a school of bunkers moving back in. We came out here prepared for albies and tog. I did not bring a snag hook or anything for stripers and blues, but mid to late October, a lot of fish are on the move, a lot of bait fish are on the move, so there are so many fishing opportunities. So these look like happy bunker there. They're not being bothered by bluefish or stripers, so I don't feel too bad about not having my pencil poppers with me, but the truck isn't that far away. I'll motor back in if I have to. I'm getting bit.
Yeah, just like everything else this time of year with the fall run, starts sliding south. Even the bunker starts sliding south. That looks like a good one, Jimmy.
Yeah, probably a little bit short, but it's so much fun.
There he is.
Oh, getting going.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
Oh, look at him go. Wow. I mean, they're short, stocky fish. They're built to dive like that, to get back to the bottom. These aren't albies. They're not moving fast, attacking bait. Oh, he's a nice fish. That's a keeper.
They're a wrasse family. They live around structure. They poke around there. They eat crabs, mussels. And so they don't need to be fast. They just need to be strong. There we go. Nice fish.
When the tog bite gets hot and heavy, you'll end up rebaiting after almost every drop. But with a bit of prep work before launching, you can maximize your fishing time.
So when you're out there actually kayak fishing for tog, you don't want to be having to reach behind you a lot of times and getting the crabs, or to be cutting them there, covering yourself with crab legs and shells. I certainly do it. But it's a little bit easier if you go and cut your bait ahead of time. And no matter where I'm tog fishing, or you know, from my kayak, from shore, from a boat, I try a couple different ways of cutting the green crab to see what the tog wants. Some days they want it, you know, we'll take all the legs off first, then you cut it in half, you have a nice, whoop, nice half of the green crab there without the legs. Other days, it seems to get more bites with the legs on. You just have to get out there and see what is getting the most bites from the keeper-sized fish and the larger fish. But I'm gonna fill up a couple of these little containers for me and Kevin, and that way we don't have to cut them while we're out there. So when the bite gets fast and furious, you miss a fish, you wanna get back down there quickly. You don't wanna waste time by just having to cut up your bait out there. Without question, the most popular bait for tog are green crabs. Pretty much any bait shop in the Northeast is gonna carry green crabs whenever tog season's open. They're relatively inexpensive for a bait. You can get a whole quart of them for about $3-4 in most places. For a full day of tog fishing, you probably want 2 quarts for each guy who's out there if you're going to be spending a couple hours. They do go pretty quickly when the bite's on. But they're basically just a small little crab. They live right in the intertidal zone, so sometimes they'll be on land. Most of the time they're under the hanging under rocks. And they're easy to find, easy to buy bait for blackfish. I'm taking a green crab half just like that. I'm gonna go through one of the leg sockets, just like that, and get it just so the barb and the point are coming through. And what that's gonna do on the bottom, it's gonna sit just like that on the rocks, has the crab pointed, presented up really nicely for the tog to come over and scoop it up off the bottom. And there are a number of great tog jigs on the market. This one's actually made by Tsunami. This is called their Tog Treats. Joe Bags makes a nice one. I have some of those I'll be fishing as well. And the key to a good blackfish jig is a real stout hook, something that's not gonna bend out because these fish are pretty strong and they're gonna be banging around the rocks a whole bunch. And also something that's gonna, when it's on the bottom, it lays like that. If you have a ball jig or a more rounded jig, it'll flip to the side. You're just not gonna have the hook pointed up. With the hook constantly pointed up like that, you're gonna have a much better hookup ratio with the tog.
And the gear we're using today, I mean, where we're fishing is probably, we're never gonna be deeper than 25, 30 feet. There's a little bit of current and tide, but not a lot. And so jigging for these fish, you can use a spinning rod jigging setup like this. This is a Shimano Travala jigging rod. I use this for all kinds of bottom fishing, sea bass, fluke, tog. It's got a surprising amount of backbone, even though it's a really light rod. You're using braid, so it's a nice way to fight these fish. You really enjoy it. You feel the bite on a jig. And we're not fishing like real craggy structure. We're fishing kind of big rocks and boulders. If I was on a wreck, I might go with something heavier, because you don't want them to get into the wreck. But here, it's really much more fun. It makes catching the throwbacks fun. They're not all keepers. And when you do get a keeper, it's a great battle.
Nice big cup holders. You can throw that bait right in there. And I got bait right at hand. I can use the other cup holder for my Yeti. I'm gonna set up a GoPro, and then I think we're gonna launch. I think we're ready to go. So I've been kayak fishing for about 15 years now. I started off with, I had a sit-inside kayak. Really not the best thing for fishing, but I'd use it to get out to some new places. Upgraded to a sit-on-top paddle kayak. And that's about when they started to make kayaks more for fishing. Moved to a pedal kayak, which I still love to fish from. Pedal kayak's great because all of a sudden your hands are free. And so now you can hold a rod, you can fish. You're steering with one hand, you're pedaling. There's no putting the paddle down when you see fish or you want to start fishing. And then this is really the next evolution in kayak fishing, as they keep making kayaks and more options that are made for fishermen. So this kayak itself right here, this is the Old Town Sportsman Autopilot 136. This is
from Old Town, which is a company owned by a larger company called Johnson Outdoors. And why that matters is because Johnson Outdoors also has Minn Kota trolling motors and Humminbird fish finders. And so now they can use all those brands together. And you've got a kayak made by Old Town with the Minn Kota trolling motor, with the Humminbird fish finder, and it all works together perfectly. I've got the spot lock power of Minn Kota, the fish finding power from the Humminbird, and then this Old Town platform, which I can do all kinds of fishing from. This kayak's unbelievably stable. I feel totally comfortable standing right now. There's not a lot of waves, but it is October. The water's pretty cold. I'm wearing a life jacket. When you're kayak fishing, always, always, always wear a personal flotation device. I don't care if it's summer, if it's winter. It's a good idea to always have one on, whether you need to or not for the law. That's just the basic rule of safety when you're fishing in a kayak.
Oh, that's a better one.
That's a better one. That'll keep.
With the sun about to sink into Buzzards Bay, Kevin and I put the rods in the holders and cruise back to the beach. The tog we've kept are destined for chowder, some of which I'll pour into airtight containers and freeze. In the winter months ahead, I'll periodically take a frozen block of chowder, heat it up, and with each steaming spoonful, look back on the past fishing season and look forward to the season ahead.
I'm Andy Nabreski, and today I'm going to show you how to make a mean fish chowder. Today I'm working with Tautog, also known as blackfish, and this really excels in something like a chowder. It's actually my favorite fish for a good fish chowder. We're going to start off by making a fish stock, which is really the foundation for a good chowder. I have a nice bowl of butts here. We get some onion butts, carrot butts, celery butts, a couple potato butts. I'm going to throw those all in the pot. I'm just gonna add in about a tablespoon of olive oil. And we're gonna brown those vegetables for about 5 to 7 minutes. All right, next step is we have these lovely Tautog racks. You definitely wanna make sure that they are gutted, and you also wanna make sure that the gills are removed. The gills can make the stock a little bit bitter. Crack those guys, throw them in the pot. And now we're just gonna fill these so that the fish and the vegetables are just barely covered with water. Next, we're gonna add some white wine. Put about a cup of wine in there. Cover the pot, and I'm going to turn that up to high just until it comes to a boil, and then once it's up to temperature, I'm going to turn it down to low and simmer it for about a half an hour to 45 minutes. So this is about 3 cups of fish. We have 3 cups of potatoes, and we have 3 cups of diced onion. To that, we're going to use about 1.5 cups of bacon. Next step, we're going to get our bacon into our chowder pot here. I'm going to turn this up on about medium heat, and we're going to add in our bacon. All right, the next step, I am gonna brown the fish in a cast iron skillet before I actually put it into the chowder. So we're just gonna preheat our cast iron skillet. And I'm gonna put that on about medium heat, and I'm really gonna let that heat up for about 10 minutes to get the pan really hot. Next step, we're gonna season our Tautog fillets. Just gonna hit them with some kosher salt and some black pepper. And now we're just gonna give all these little guys a little dusting in flour. All right, the handle on this cast iron skillet is now hot to touch. That means our pan is hot enough. We're gonna add just a little bit of olive oil, don't need a lot. We're gonna add our tog fillets to the pan. We're just gonna brown those for about 2 to 3 minutes on each side, just until they just start picking up a little bit of color. We wanna get our bacon really nice and crispy because we're actually gonna use this as a garnish at the end when the chowder's done. All right, these guys have been on here for about 3 minutes. And they're just starting to get a little bit of nice color, a little golden brown. All right, our bacon bits are looking lovely. They are nice and crispy. We're gonna remove these with a slotted spoon. And now we're gonna discard all but about a tablespoon of the bacon fat. We're gonna leave a little bit in there to cook our onions in. Next step is the onions. We have 3 cups of yellow onion diced. I'm gonna add that to the chowder pot, and we're gonna cook those down until they're almost translucent, probably about 10 to 12 minutes. And it looks like a lot of onions, but these are gonna really shrivel up and cook down. Our fish has just a nice amount of brownness to it. Remove that from the pan and set that aside. Anytime I'm making a chowder, whether it's a fish chowder or a clam chowder, the 2 herbs that I think are critical to making it good are fresh dill and fresh thyme. So I like to season the chowder as I go along. I do a little bit at the beginning, I season a little bit at the end. So I'm gonna add just a little bit of thyme and fresh dill to the onions. And just a pinch of both in there. Give that a stir. Our fish stock has been simmering for about 45 minutes now. It looks about right. I'm gonna bring this over to the sink and strain it out. I just have a colander placed in a metal dish. Pour that out. And here we have some lovely fish stock made from Tautog heads. Our onions are looking good. They're pretty much all translucent, starting to brown just a little bit. That's about where we want them. The next step is gonna be to fire the potatoes into the pot. I like to use red potatoes just because the skin gives the chowder a little bit of color. It's a pretty bland looking dish otherwise. And now we want to top this off with fish stock until the potatoes are just barely covered. We're going to put a lid on it, crank the heat up a little bit, about medium low. We're going to simmer those off until the potatoes are soft, probably could be anywhere 8 to 12 minutes. So we can turn the heat off at this point. And now it's time to make a roux. All right, so a roux is essentially just butter and flour, and this is what we're gonna use to thicken the chowder. So I'm gonna go with about 3 tablespoons of butter. And anytime you're making a roux, it's always equal parts of butter to flour. So first we need to melt the butter. So now we're gonna add 3 tablespoons of flour to our 3 tablespoons of melted butter. Make sure we get all that flour incorporated and get all the lumps out of it. And once that is all evenly mixed together, you're gonna add 1 cup of whole milk. And we really wanna keep this moving once we put the milk in there, just kinda continuously stir it, and this is gonna thicken up pretty quickly. Now, once we see bubbles starting to come up in this mixture, we're gonna wanna really keep this moving, and we're gonna cook it down for about a minute, and that's really gonna thicken it up quite substantially. Add that into the chowder pot. Next up is another secret weapon in my chowder. I put a little evaporated milk in there, and this gives it a little bit of sweetness, which I really like. So I'm gonna do 1 14-ounce can of evaporated milk. So I'm gonna add in about 1/2 cup of light cream. I'm gonna add in a touch more fresh herbs, a little more thyme, and just a little bit more dill. And now it's time to add our tautog. And this will break up into smaller chunks as it continues to cook. And this is kind of where the magic happens. The zen of a chowder is really when all those flavors kind of sit and meld together in the pan. I'll let this sit for an hour. It's actually even better if you let it sit even overnight, which you would put it in the refrigerator, obviously. All those flavors kind of snuggle up and they get sucked in by the potatoes. That's really where the magic of a good fish chowder happens. So we're gonna let this guy rest right here. We're gonna crack a beer, we're gonna pet the dog. And we'll watch some football, and we'll come back in about an hour and finish this up. All right, so our chowder's been sitting here for about an hour or so, meddling, doing its thing. We'll ladle some of this up for the camera boys here. And did you forget about those bacon bits? Because I did not forget about those bacon bits. It's time to take those out of hiding. I'm just gonna put a pinch of these right on top for garnish, for crunch, and for smokiness. Pretty, pretty, pretty good. It's a good batch. Tautog chowder, one of my favorites.